Last but certainly not least, we have value-based care and payment models, and our two presenters will be Dr. Boulanger and Madi Edelstein.
Good morning. We'll wait for the music to stop before we get started. It's a real privilege to be sharing the stage with Madi Edelstein, who's our new Chief Revenue Officer. Madi has brought from Long Island some expertise here to UK Healthcare to help us with value-based care and with value-based reimbursement. We'd like to share some of those ideas with you. Why are we discussing value today? Why are we discussing value-based care at all? Why is it included in the 2020 strategic plan? The reason is that UK Healthcare will not be successful unless we are very good at delivering value to our patients and value to the purchasers of care. Our long-term success depends on it. We'll discuss what is value in healthcare, a little bit about what is value-based healthcare. Madi will go into value-based reimbursement, which is very facile at. Then we'll briefly discuss what we're doing to prepare here at UK Healthcare for value-based healthcare and value-based reimbursement. We actually start a little bit ahead of time, so we're gonna slow down on the rapid fire a little bit. You know, it looks like we have a little bit more time for you. What is value in healthcare? You know, this is one quote that's often used by the CEO of the Mayo Clinic. We have some Mayo Clinic people here with us in the audience today, Jenny, Craig, and others. That's quality and an affordable cost. That's really value. What does value mean to our patients and the purchasers of healthcare? And we put up CMS, Humana, Anthem here. You know, they're obviously purchasers of healthcare, but employers more and more are purchasers of healthcare, directly purchasers of healthcare. What does value mean to that patient on the screen? What is that? What does value mean to you? When you order something online, what's value mean to you in that transaction? We need to start thinking more about value in healthcare, more about value at UK Healthcare. We need to develop a mindset of value. You know, and that's something as leaders in the audience, we're gonna have to help our people develop that mindset of value, to be thinking about value. And it's a different mindset than we're used to. This is the value equation that you may have seen before. This is an important equation to look at. Those of you that are mathematically inclined will recognize there's a numerator and there's a denominator. You can manipulate the value delivered by manipulating the factors in the numerator, the denominator. You also have to look at this equation relative to who you're asking. If you're asking the patient, if we're delivering high value to them, their costs will be their out-of-pocket costs. And with rising deductibles, the changes in copay, consumer out-of-pocket costs are having more and more of an effect on the choice patients make about their care. When you look at the value equation also, you see quality service, which is patient experience generally, and access. Mark mentioned access. We've put a lot of effort into ensuring access for hospital transfers. And I think Mark Randall highlighted we also need to start now thinking more about access to ambulatory care, access to the portal, patients' information on the portal. There are some centers that put other things in the numerator, such as medical appropriateness. Right? Medical appropriateness, as you know, has got a lot of press in our state when it comes to procedures. Medical appropriateness is in there as well somewhere. So what is value-based healthcare? One way to think about it is that reimbursement is shifting from volume to value. What does that mean? That's even hard to conceive. I mean, we've all been raised on fee-for-service. I mean, hospitals generally have been raised on fee-for-service. The DRG payment system that came into the 80s sort of changed that somewhat, but still it's fee-for-service. Certainly on the physician side, we as physicians were raised on fee-for-service. The more you do something, the more you make. And it doesn't really depend on how well you do it. That's the big change. That's the big change in the mindset. And for the first time, it links the quality of patient care and the cost of the care and the reimbursement for the care into one package. We have normally thought of those things as separate things. That's the value mindset, is to think of them all at once. There are many initiatives that we've included in the strategic plan to help us be prepared and to be successful with value-based healthcare. We need to work on issues in the numerator and also in the denominator, but we have to have the capabilities in order to manage those things. And those include data, they include analytics, they include incentivizing the right behaviors. When it comes to the quality program, that's a very important part of value-based healthcare. It is a numerator of the value-based healthcare. And we've had a fair amount of success here considering the conventional measures of quality, length of stay, patient safety, and so on. But we need to mature in our thinking when it comes to the measurement of our care delivery, measuring the value we're delivering rather than just the HCAHPS results or our length of stay or our mortality rates. Now, value-based reimbursement, I'll hand this over to Monty.
Thank you. So you've been hearing this morning all about changes in healthcare, changes in the way that we're going to provide care, service line models, et cetera. One of the things that I get to deal with is figure out how we get paid for these changes in healthcare. And if we're going to talk to an insurance company and ask them to continue paying for us, and you saw some slides before about having employers involved and having insurance companies involved, and as we change our models and as we change our care, how do we get paid for it? And one of the top, I guess, key terminologies that healthcare payment structures have been talking about over the past few years is this concept of value-based reimbursement or value-based care translationing into not just getting paid because I provided a service, but because I'm taking care of a much larger spectrum of healthcare. The Marks before spoke about the and I guess everyone really spoke about the cycles of care and the places of care. When we turn that into value, we have to start talking about how we get reimbursed for it. I guess we can actually ask this question if anybody knows the difference, but these are buzzwords that people are talking about. Anybody hear about things like bundle payments? Show of hands. Yeah. Risk-based contracts. We've heard that today a few times, the concept of risk-based. Do we really know how we're going to operationalize that? How we're going to measure that internally? How we're going to bill insurance companies for it? How we gather information and track data? Because today, the way we track data is we get an encounter from a patient, we go to all that patient information, and then we send a whole bunch of information to an insurance company. This changes the whole model of the way we operationalize healthcare and financial data. Narrow networks, anybody hear of that terminology? That's a new one. Okay, so I won't go into too much. Bundle payments, we sort of have those concepts, right? An insurance company gives us a payment, we got to take care of an episode. A risk-based contract is an insurance company saying, here is X number of dollars, whether it's per month or per year, take care of my patient or my employee. A narrow network is where we get into a narrow scope and say, you know what, we think this small group of maybe specialists or this small group of primary care doctors or this small group of a mixture of primary care and specialties can do better at providing care and at providing value-based care. So we're going to contract with just them to take care of our patients. And it's a new model because it goes away from the concept of going to see any doctor you want to see, going to see any hospital you want to go to, because it narrows your potential. And then the direct-to-employer strategies. And that's basically, as we grow as a healthcare entity, providing value-based care, It means that we no longer need to deal directly with an insurance company per se. We can deal directly with employers, and we can start offering services to employers to keep their patients healthy. So that circle of care doesn't necessarily wait until there's an acute episode of care where they have to come to a hospital for. I guess the easiest way to describe, this is a busy slide, the easiest way to describe this is as follows. In order to convince people to start thinking about value-based care, and in order to get people to want to spend the effort and the resources, there's two models. There's the model of, we'll pay you to do a certain service better, or there's a model of, we'll take money away from you if you don't do it better. And what's happening is that these value-based purchasing models, these healthcare acquired conditions of trying to reach certain metrics have become a mechanism for CMS and for some of our payers to even start talking to us about, well, if you don't do well, we're going to take some money away from you. Or on the flip side, if you do a little bit better than the way you should or than what you would have in the past, we'll actually give you some more money. And what that does is it starts incentivizing us to figure out better models of providing value-based care. I guess as time goes on, because we're really at the beginning of this concept of value-based care, we haven't begun, you know, service models yet. We haven't begun really deep conversations with payers or with employers on how to create a value-based payment structure. We're just having those conversations now. We're having, you know, strategic planning happening and lots of work sessions on figuring out where we move from there. But the continuum of this is to try to get those incentives and try to figure out how we start. Where do we get the data from? Who do we share the data with? And how do we start getting paid for having that information? Bundle payments, I think we're sort of already down the road of doing. There are certain cardiac procedures. We're moving towards certain orthopedic procedures where we have that concept of a bundle payment model. What we're really focusing on now, probably the next year or two, is this concept of shared risk. So it's probably smack in the middle of what value-based care and transition happens. It's we don't want to take a downside because we're not yet really sure on how to manage the value of a patient, but at the same time, we want to get paid more in order to be able to continue this model of formulating value care, getting teams of people and approaches around it, and then afford to pay for it. And so the shared risk model is where, as a healthcare entity, we sort of, you know, dip our toes in the water a little bit. We figure out with an insurance company, with CMS, you know, how do we take shared risk on patient populations? How do we provide data in order to be able to understand how we're doing with treating patients in a value-based model? And then obviously, how do we get paid a little bit more in that model as well? And then as we move across that spectrum, we're going to end up in understanding what it means to take full risk, where we get a patient population, we have to provide value-based care to that population, which includes all the denominator and numerator things that Bernie showed before. It's got to include quality, it's got to include access, because that's the value proposition. And in a full risk arrangement, we have no choice but to make sure that we're providing the value and the efficiencies and the quality of care, because that's how we will get paid, and otherwise we won't end up on the top side of the financial model. And then the last piece of it is the insurance model. It's the concept of the providers bearing the full insurance risk, where we sort of maybe take the insurance company management of a patient out of the equation, and where the healthcare entity as a whole, in a value-based model setting, is really responsible for and is thinking about how that cost structure and how the spending of the dollars happen to that patient, and it's not waiting for that acute, urgent need where the price is the highest. It's taking care of that patient from the primary care model, the urgent care model, the nutrition model, keeping them healthy before they reach the acute need of a expensive hospital care, and then working with those employers, patients, and the insurance companies to understand what data do we need in order to understand how to take care of those patients. and what data sharing do we need in order to make sure that we're doing it in a cost-effective manner, and then ultimately providing this value concept so that the patient chooses UK healthcare at the end of the day, not because there's a certain procedure they need to come to or there's a certain need that's happening in the ER or with a specialist, but they're choosing UK healthcare because we've closed that circle. And that from their initial visit with a primary care doctor or even their initial visit at a gym, that a patient now is part of a continuum of care where we won't mind taking that risk as a health entity because we're sharing that entire healthcare cycle with the patient. And therefore, it brings back the value concept, the cost, the quality, the efficiencies, the access. It brings everything under one roof, and it makes it worthwhile for us financially. What are bundled payments?
Across the country, healthcare providers are experimenting with new models to try and make healthcare more affordable. One of the more promising of those models is called bundled payment. And right now, nearly 500 hospitals have signed up to test bundled payments with Medicare, commercial payers, and large employers. Sounds great, but what exactly is a bundled payment? Well, a bundled payment is basically a single fixed payment amount designed to pay all the providers involved in an episode of care. So, say grandma needs a hip replacement. That single lump sum would cover the costs for the hospital, physician, physical therapy, possibly readmissions, and so on. That's a big leap from how healthcare is paid for today. Under the system we have now, what we call fee-for-service, each provider who treats a patient across that episode is paid separately. All those individual payments reinforce individual effort, but nobody's responsible for coordinating care, and grandma ends up bombarded with bills. Now, in a bundled payment model, that combined lump sum aligns the incentive for all the providers. Since there's just one fixed payment amount, physicians have a stake in hospital costs, and vice versa. And if everyone works together to improve quality and efficiency, they get a share in the savings, the fixed bundle minus the actual costs. Patients benefit from that bundling too. Early bundling pilots are showing some promising quality improvement, a better coordinated experience, not to mention simplified billing. And bundled payments can also help bring down costs for insurers and employers, since that fixed bundle amount is less than the total of all those individual payments. And since providers can't bill extra for additional costs, remember it's a fixed rate, bundling makes prices a lot more transparent and predictable. Right now, most of these programs are voluntary, but still, why isn't everyone running to adopt bundled payments? Well, frankly, because there are some risks involved. Basically, everyone's betting they'll be able to deliver the same care as before, but for a lower cost. They're also taking the chance they'll be able to get all the right people to work together. So, grandma's surgeon, primary care physician, physical therapist, even the pharmacy. They're assuming they'll be able to set the pricing of those bundles correctly. Set them too low and they could be losing a lot of money every time they treat someone. And that they'll be able to coordinate the whole thing. Collecting and distributing payments, coordinating care, and finding ways to reduce costs. All that said, a lot of providers have decided the benefits of bundling for patients, purchasers, and clinical partners really do outweigh the risks. So, could bundling be in your future? The advisory board can help you find out. To learn more, check out...
Not meant to be a commercial for the advisory board.
We thought it was a great way to show, I think, the concepts, right? So you've been hearing all morning about access to care and quality of care and circles of care and the life of a patient and things of that nature. And what it comes down to is it's all of it, right? It's every single patient from the time they're born to the time they die and everything in between, and it's taking care of them. And what we're being forced to think about through our insurance companies, through CMS, through these changes in healthcare models, is how do we pay for it? How do we share that model with all the different people in healthcare? And again, I'll start from nutrition services to going to the gym, going to your primary care doctor, seeing a physician in a clinic, showing up at the emergency room, and everything in between, home care, post-acute care. We all have to work together because without working together, the costs are astronomical, And what we're finding is that as even individual areas within that mix start working together to provide value-based care, the costs go down per patient. And if the costs go down per patient, we can do more with that money. And if we can, it feeds itself. The whole service line model means that, you know, no single service line is self-sufficient without the other. And there's no such thing as a specialty anymore who's sort of siloed. We all have to work together in order to prove this value. Let's see what else we got. Some of the initiatives that we're doing. We're piloting bundle payments. We are piloting risk-based. We're doing a lot of work, especially with gathering data from our own UK employees. We don't yet have the complexity of systems throughout the institution that talk to each other in order for us to even sit at any one point in time with a lot of information. So we're starting to gather that. We're developing direct-to-employer risk models, and we're looking to start with some value-based payment models. This is the slide that says where are we today versus where we want to be. I think we're somewhere in probably year one or year two because we're starting to have these conversations. At some point in time, we want to be able to have a value-based care system. We want to be able to get paid for all the services that we provide, and we want to be able to show and prove that the quality increases with our value concepts.
Right. I think it's worth reminding ourselves that although all the reimbursement obviously very important, you know, delivering high value care to the patients is the first priority. And as Craig and Mahdi and Murray and others have said in the past, if we do that, the reimbursement is going to take care of itself. So what are we doing to prepare? We're doing a lot. You know, we've included value-based care in our strategic plan, 2020 strategic plan. That's a big step. That shows recognition of UK Health Barrett, you know, the president of the university, the governing body, in the importance of value-based health care for us. There is some guidance from around the country. This is a paper from 2013 written specifically about academic health centers and health care reform and how academic health centers with the unique characteristics that the Beau mentioned, can get ready. Number one, making patients the center of attention is paramount. Now, we say we're patient-centered, but we're not. We're not at all times, right? We are at times and in certain areas. We need to gradually change that mindset, as other organizations have already, to think of the patient first at all times and in all discussions. Shift to a value-conscious state of mind. This is the value mindset. We have to start thinking that way. It's going to take some time, especially those of us who have worked in the current environment for many years. Now, for our trainees, we're going to have to help them with that. And when I talk to the new incoming residents, I tell them that their livelihood will depend on how well they care for patients, not just how many patients they care for. And that's a change in the mindset for them as well. The enterprise goals, the FY16 enterprise goals, if you listen to the talks this morning and the talk Mahdi and I have given about value, when you take a look at the enterprise goals and you look at those measures, as we move the needle on those measures, we're delivering more and more value to our patients, more and more value to the purchasers of healthcare. So this is really a value delivery tool here, the enterprise goals. We've also launched the Office of Value and Innovation in Healthcare Delivery. This is a new office. Mark Williams and I and Dr. Karf and others put this together to help get us ready for value-based healthcare. One of the initiatives that have come out of that is UK Optimal Care. This is an initiative to reduce unnecessary variation in clinical care. We all recognize there's necessary variation at times, but we recognize there's unnecessary variation. When you reduce unnecessary variation with healthcare, you help the numerator of the value equation, And you also help the denominator by reducing costs, so you increase value delivery. The UK Optimal Care Initiative, really, it's the gathering of resources to assist local teams to improve. That's something we've done a little bit here. We haven't quite done enough of that. That is to help the local frontline care providers get better. Value-based healthcare, then, it links the quality of the care with the cost of care with the reimbursement for the care. Monty's alluded to the fact that it's aligned patients, payers, and healthcare providers really for the first time. And the best example of that is the readmission penalty. Readmissions align payers. They don't want their patients coming back. It aligns the patients. They generally don't want to come back unless they really have to come back. And it aligns us because now we're accountable for our readmission rates. And it makes us all consider quality and cost, as Mark and Bo and others have pointed out, across the care continuum, not just in our little silo of care. Critical success factors. We need to work to eliminate waste. We need to be more transparent. I think we've come a long way on being more transparent. And Monty?
But to me, the most important one on here is the data. And for those of you that recognize that we have so many systems out there that are capturing so many pieces of information on patients, if only we had systems that were able to talk to us on a regular basis and give us so much information back to where we need it. And I think that's a major portion of where our next steps are. It's being able to have access to the data, similar to being able to take patients, taking care of patients in its right place and right time. We need the data to help us understand things in its right place and its right time so that we can start having conversations about where we see value, about where we see service line models working, about where we see patients being treated in a more value-based arena or a cost-effective arena or a quality metric type arena. And the quicker we can get to that information, the quicker we can make decisions on it.